Thank you, everyone, and welcome to our webinar. We appreciate you showing up. I think you're going to find this one very, very interesting. What we're going to tell you is, and actually I'm not going to tell it, I'm going to leave it up to Jeff Ryan and his teachers to tell you a really interesting story about how Danville Area School District was able to leverage a variety of really cool technologies to deliver a really exceptional remote learning solution. A piece of that technology, and one of the reasons that we're talking to them, is a product called WhatsUp Gold, which is a network monitoring solution that we make here at Progress. And I'll just give you some background on it so you know what we're talking about. But basically, WhatsUp Gold is a tool that will find every device on your network, show you whether it's up, whether it's down, and how it's connected to everything else through a very simple, very easy to use interface. The main value of this is it allows you to eliminate finger pointing, identify issues that are going on with the network, and resolve them very quickly. It's a very powerful diagnostic tool. The problems we solve: network status, what's up, what's down. You can see this sort of thing at a glance. We have an intuitive mapping interface, and I don't know if Jeff's going to show it to you, but we also have some very powerful and very customizable dashboards, which make it very easy for our users to figure out exactly what it is they need to see at an instant's notice. We can monitor anything that's plugged into your network. It doesn't matter whether that's a device, whether it's a web resource, whether it's a virtual device. If it can talk to your network in any way more sophisticated than two tin cans and a string, we can talk to it, we can get information about it, and we can show you how it's doing. And the main goal of all of this is to let IT teams know the health of their network, and not just to let them know when issues occur, but usually to let them know what's happening before things start to get bad. They can see bandwidth starting to hit limits. They can see systems getting stressed. They can see systems starting to go down. And the whole point of this is to allow them to fix problems before their end users are impacted. So when you go into work and everything's working perfectly and the network is up, you don't think about it. That's because there are unsung heroes like Jeff behind the scenes who are fixing problems before they impact you. And the main value of WhatsUp Gold is it allows them to proactively find and fix problems fast. And with that said, it is one piece of how Jeff has been able to develop this really impressive remote learning solution. So with that said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn everything over to Jeff to let him demonstrate what he's done, how he's put it together, the other technology he's using, and why his solution has been so effective. We will have plenty of time for Q&A at the end, so stay tuned. I think you're going to enjoy this. Jeff, are you ready?
All right, let's go to it. Thank you, Mark, for the introduction. And I, you know, first and foremost, I want to thank everyone from Progress. It's been an excellent bunch to work with. You know, Hope and Mark and Alexandra and John has made this scenario possible and have been excellent to work with. So thank you to you guys. And then secondly, one thing that you'll hear me throughout this presentation is just how important my staff and everyone that has worked to make this all possible, you know, how important they all are. There's so many people. I hope I get everybody through this presentation that has been part of this, because it is a conceited effort. Originally, conceptually, you know, maybe something that I thought of and put together, but it couldn't be possible, you know, unless everyone was involved, you know, all shareholders, from the administration to our superintendent, first and foremost, Dr. Boyle, our administration, our principals, our curriculum director, Dr. Bickhart, and then, you know, all of our tech staff. And last but definitely not least, our teachers. They're absolutely fantastic and took this head on and have done an absolutely excellent job. So I just wanted to make sure, you know, I started out with that. And, you know, with that all behind us, we'll start talking about virtual classroom. Everyone has their own idea of virtual classroom. And it kind of caught us all off guard, you know, back in March. You know, we've been doing a lot of things in technology and education for a long time. But in last March, with the COVID-19 pandemic, you know, really kind of put education on a spot because of the fact that now suddenly we had to be able to teach our kids, you know, virtually at their homes. And it was a tough situation. There wasn't a lot of time. And truthfully, early on, there wasn't a whole lot of valuable education going on because it was just so fast. So, you know, we finished out the year and then everyone started meeting over and over and over again to come up with a better scenario because the uncertainty that was going to happen this fall, and uncertainty is probably a kind word for it. We all, you know, sat down, hunkered down, and tried to think of ways. And one thing that our district that wanted to do, above, you know, traditional cyber where you put your materials out there and then people kind of self-serve, they wanted to do a virtual environment where, you know, teachers could interact with students and give them a classroom experience at home. And they all turned to me and said, okay, you know, we want to do this, cameras, all kinds of stuff. And at that point, you know, it was a pretty scary moment for me, I got to admit. And what we did was step back, you know, me and my couple of guys that worked for me, you know, took a hard look at it, and they came up with an early solution, and we looked at that, and it didn't work. And then finally, after some research and seeing what some other people have done, we came up with this solution. And that's basically what this is all about. And the big part of it that I can't begin to stress enough is that the major part of making this work is infrastructure and proactively monitoring your infrastructure. If you don't have a sound infrastructure where you could be reliably doing things on a consistent basis, like we are right now. Right now, we are teaching virtually in our school district. We are on this call, doing this webinar at the same exact time. So it shows you, you know, the confidence that we have in our infrastructure. And along with having, you know, a solid infrastructure is, you know, having a great proactive monitoring system. And we use WhatsUp Gold. Originally, you know, when I started my discussions with Progress and we did, it was a case study done on us, you know, I told them right off, this is, I love your product. I'm not saying it because when I'm looking for any recognition or anything of that sort, it's because the product is solid and we use it on a daily basis. And it is the most valuable thing when it, as far as determining when there's problems happening. As of yesterday, this is a scary situation. We had an ISP outage, and it was kind of an odd outage because it was only part of the internet. Something on their head end was definitely wrong, but we were able to determine that there was a problem pretty much instantaneously, and we were ahead of it. Not that we can control what the ISP does to fix it, but ultimately we were able to kind of get ahead of it and put some announcements out to the teacher to kind of quell the panic. Fortunately, our Google Meet and things of that nature were still going, and that wasn't interrupted, but that just shows you one example of how we use it. So I'm going to go ahead and go through my presentation here, go through my slides. So we had a couple operational considerations. You know, first and foremost, can our infrastructure handle and the equipment we had handle the load of what partial virtual or full virtual would mean? And so that was a very important aspect. Number two is, do we have the hardware we need to make it happen? Another essential, you know, if you don't have the right equipment in place, the right tool for the job, that's another problem. And do we have software that is flexible enough to match our needs? As you see later on in this presentation, that was a big, huge point. And can we provide adequate training to make this setup effective and sustainable? You know, one of the biggest things, you know, I keep saying there's big things, but there's a lot of big key aspects in making something like this work. And professional development in the educational world is absolutely essential. And preparing the teachers and, you know, being a resource for them is absolutely critical. And so that is a big part of what we do. And I'm going to bring in another person that I'm very thankful for, and that's Mr. Breon. He is our integration, curriculum integration specialist. And basically, you know, he works with the teachers in technology, and he developed some fantastic training materials, and that sets us up ultimately for success. As far as infrastructure goes, to kind of dive in a little deeper, one thing that we do not, we're not afraid to spend money on is infrastructure. Ultimately, you're only going to go as well as your infrastructure and the backbone that you you sit up on top of. So, you know, we have an enterprise firewall, we have enterprise switches, Of course, we have enterprise wireless. We have, for a relatively small school, we have a lot of internet bandwidth. One thing that we're going to probably expand upon, and we haven't to this point, is a redundant wireless solution. Right now, we're not at that, but we fortunately, knock on wood, we haven't had any major problems. But we've got to, when we become more reliant on it, we have to have that type of solution in place. And then, of course, the big one, proactive monitoring. Being able to see your latency, have your dashboard up. Mark spoke about the dashboard. That's one of the things that I keep up all the time, and I'll show you that in a bit. Being able to see the traffic flow, being able to drill down to see when there's, some spikes, to see where, if there's particular devices that are causing issues, and then, switch issues and just all kinds of stuff. And then another thing we watch, through WhatsUp Gold, on a consistent basis, is wireless itself, to see that, our access points are getting inundated. And we kind of like to spread the load out between our access points and not have any devices that are getting too many clients at one time. So that's one thing that we watch. And then we're very proud here. We maintain, 99% of our stuff in-house, so we can fix it quick. And that proactive monitoring helps with finding those problems and getting those problems taken care of as soon as there's a problem that exists. Our equipment, this is a base equipment for the virtual. Of course, we have a lot more than this in-house, but the big main components, teacher laptop is the hub of it all, document camera, web camera, projector, cables and peripherals, the student Chromebooks, and then we have hotspots for situations where students can't get internet at home. We have a certain number of hotspots that we can go ahead and, deliver out to our students to accommodate, people that can't either afford them or are in a situation where they can't get it for some reason. So we do that as well, and that's important to have. The base software, of course, WhatsUp Gold's on the top of the list to proactively monitor everything that's happening. Of course, our Windows 10 operating system, which all of our laptops sit on top of, the Chrome OS, the Google G Suite for Education. We are a Google site. There's a couple of other solutions that districts can use. We are a Google Suite, Sites, Classroom. Google Meet is a huge part, of course. It's kind of what runs all of our virtual classrooms. Drive and Docs, we do a lot of collaboration and for virtual learning. And then Gmail for communication. And the big one that kind of stands out in our solution and kind of sets us apart is OBS. And OBS is Open Broadcasting Software, Broadcaster Software. And it's basically been used, for a while now with the gamer community and YouTube live streamers. Kind of an odd solution, for us to use, for in a classroom, because it is open source. But it solved our needs. I mean, it basically, when they asked me, to do this scenario, I was thinking to myself, how can we possibly do this? They want to, be able to see the teacher and teach at the same time and do all this crazy stuff. I'm thinking to myself, how can this possibly happen? And the reality is, they need to have a studio, basically a little TV studio in their classroom to make this happen. And basically OBS allows them to do that. And in its base functionality, OBS is real pretty simple to use, and it can be used just to switch between your sources. You know, your document camera, your webcam, and, you know, your Chrome browser. That, you know, is what OBS is basically used to do in a basic scenario. But then you can expand upon that. There's much more that you can do with OBS and take it to another level. And you can not only do it and switch between them, but the key is, see, you know, it's a quick, you know, seamless type of transition between devices. And I'll show you that in a few moments. But it makes it real easy for you to, you know, be able to switch between those different sources. And it really has kind of, you know, helped us and has made us take off from, you know, in the virtual learning. And just to attest to just how valuable it has become to us. You know, we just had a discussion this morning. You know, we have some things going on at our school district, you know, and, you know, with the uprise in COVID, you know, we have the ability to basically transition from full virtual to, you know, one day on, one day off, to a hybrid. There's a bunch of different things that we can do, and we can do it quickly because everyone knows how to use it. And we can basically switch, you know, from one day to the next if we had to. And that's real valuable coming forward because there is, you know, a spike right now in the COVID virus. So, you know, there is some expectations that at some time in the near future, we may be forced to go full virtual. So, you know, the next piece was training. You know, there's a lot of things that we did training wise that helped us. You know, we front loaded our professional development days and started a little bit later so we could provide our teachers some more time to practice with OBS and with this virtual scenario. So that was huge. You know, we gave them a lot of videos and how-tos, and then of course we did some personal training as well, but it was kind of a la carte. They could go in and pick the trainings they want and watch them, and so we offered them a lot of resources, and ultimately that was a huge part. And then the third part, we didn't have technology leads for a while, and you know, we decided over the summer that it's a big part. We needed to actually assign some teachers some technology leads so we could give more resources, because, you know, our Mr. Breon, our integration specialist, is just one man. And, you know, there's a lot of people in the district, you know, a good 250 to 300, staff that would need to utilize him. So we selected some technology leads and in from each building to help, and it you know, proved to be invaluable, especially towards, you know, the beginning when we needed to roll this out and when people needed a lot of help early on. We had those resources, and Mr. Tittman, one of the teachers that is a technology lead, is actually presenting today, and he has done a fantastic job. So, as well as every one of our technology leads. So there's another shout out to all of our technology leads, because they have done a fantastic job. So just going through each, you know, piece of software, of course, you know, our host, you know, Progress Software and WhatsUp Gold, fantastic. I used WhatsUp Gold when I was in the business environment. And it had to been back in the early 2000s, and it was, you know, still in its infancy. It may have been around for a little while, but I don't think it had been around for that long. And you know, I, in my couple stints, you know, and then when I went, moved forward from that company, you know, and then went into education, I looked back, looked at other software, and I actually had tried another piece of software. I believe the name of the software was SolarWinds, and that did proactive monitoring as well, but it didn't fit my needs quite as much as I'd remember WhatsUp Gold. So I ended up going back to WhatsUp Gold, and they had actually drastically improved their product, and it was a fantastic addition when I started using it. And after that, I set it all up. The ease of use was, to get it all set up and get all my devices on there and get them mapped out and create my dashboard and do all that, was easy to get up and running. I also, do some NetFlow and S-Flow through my firewall and my switches, so I could see real-time traffic. And of course, I have, the wireless hooked into my Meraki wireless solution through a Meraki API, which gives me my information from my wireless as well. So I kind of have, everything I need right there now with WhatsUp Gold. So that's a fantastic product to have, and has kind of helped me troubleshoot problems as well as proactively monitor. And I also have a lot of reports kick out on weekly and daily basis. I'm a real nerd when it comes to data. So I have, all these reports and charts and things, so I can monitor how things are over time, and kind of assess. I'm constantly trying to assess our solutions to try to make sure that I'm doing the best possible and the least interrupt. The way I see it is the least amount of time that people see me, the better I am at what I do. So if there's people out there that probably think, well, what does that guy do? And to me, that's a good thing. And I had a great compliment the other day. I had a teacher come to me with a problem, and I was showing her, we were going over the problem and figuring out what was going on. And she said, I know this is kind of a backhanded comment, she said, but everything works so well around here that when something goes wrong, we like panic and think, that you guys are doing something down there. To me, that's a testament to all the hard work that, I've put in, and all the guys in my team, and everyone in my team has put into it. So that is a great thing. Here's some pictures of, at the top is my dashboard, basically, ping response time, disk utilization, ping availability, everything in here, memory utilization. I watch all that. So if I see any potential problems coming up, I can get ahead of them. On the bottom left, you can see a traffic analysis dashboard showing, my traffic. And I believe that was either yesterday or the day before. There was that drop we had with our provider yesterday. You can see it, in the 12, between 12 and 12:30 time, or yeah, 12 and 12:30 time frame. That doesn't make me happy, but I know when it happens, I can see it. And then on the underneath there is my AP client counts that I watch to make sure that none of my APs are being inundated. Here is, and then of course, a big part of what we do is Google G Suite for Education. I won't get into all of that, but we use Classroom and Google Meet extensively to deliver our content. So now I get to Open Broadcaster software. So this is kind of the X factor in what we do. It's a free and open source cross-platform streaming and recording program built with Qt and maintained by the OBS project. And I want to thank them, whoever they are out there, for this product. It's really helped us, deliver some valuable education to students at home. And what I'm going to actually do is kind of the best way to show is go through some OBS functionality. Actually, right now, as we're speaking, I'm using OBS to deliver my video. So if I kind of back out of my presentation here, I am going to show you, I am sharing my screen, showing my Chrome browser, and then I'm going to go ahead and switch to my webcam. So here I am. I'm sorry if I don't always get myself centered, but I'm going to show you how quickly I switch through these. I'm not used to being, the center of, of attention. So I'm not used to centering myself. I'm sure the teachers are much better at this. But OBS allows me to quickly, switch from my Chrome browser, which I was on before, and switch over to my webcam. And then I can switch to my document camera. And here's my doc cam on my, on my desk. And the teachers use this a whole lot. This is their actual chalkboard, as nowadays, because they can project. They have a copy of what's happening on the board for the kids in the classroom, and then the kids at home also see it, through OBS. So it's nice and it's consistent. So I'm gonna do the famous 1 + 1 = 2, just to show you, how smooth and how well it works. It is used heavily. You can bring, objects in. This is our little stream deck I'm using to switch scenes. And I can turn my recording off and things off and program keys for that through OBS. A lot of demonstrations and stuff are also done through the webcam, which is really awesome. And you'll see that happening live here in a little bit with some of our teachers. A lot of teachers also like to have waiting rooms that they put up, and they'll play music and do other things. What's nice is you can put layers in. So if I go back to my webcam, I have, image background that I can put in the background, as well as overlay text. And I can turn things on and off, to show certain things. They can get really complicated, and you'll see that with the teacher demonstrations coming up. Another big one is the Chrome browser. You can demonstrate things and do slide presentations and go on the web to demonstrate things as well. And then another part of that is I could throw my webcam down in the bottom corner. This is the power over just standard, Zoom meetings or Google Meet meetings. It's the personal aspect that is added into this whole scenario. So you can see there I am down in the bottom corner, and then, this is my current dashboard of what's happening in the district with my WhatsUp Gold, as well as my traffic. You can see we've already done 600. This is my firewall, 630 gig almost. Oh, just went over 630 gig of traffic already today. We're nearing the end of the day, so the traffic will go down here shortly. And then, of course, this is a look at my client count on my access points. I have a lot more access points, but I watch my heavily used ones just to make sure. I do have one access point here that I can see went over, a client count of 30. I will probably look at that just to make sure that's just not an ongoing problem. But WhatsUp Gold not only gives you the ability to see these quick views, but then drill down in and look at the details, also as well. So, that's OBS in a nutshell. I mean, you could do other things. I made this little graphic, this silly graphic of me dancing. I can, you can turn things on and off so teachers can pre-make things. bring it in, make things fun. We have teachers that do, you know, waiting rooms with seasonal themes to them, with pumpkins. You can also change the shape of the window of your webcam. You can make it in the shape of a pumpkin. It's unbelievable the customization of what you can do with OBS. But that's, you know, and I have another one I'm going to show you quick here. I have my phone. You're going to about to see just how messy my office is. I'm so sorry about that. But it shows how I'm getting buried alive with products. So if I can switch, actually, if I to my phone cam, and hopefully it works. On the fly. So here's a webcam, and you can see I've got all kinds of boxes coming in and things, and you can see on, you know, my desk here where I'm at and what I have up on my desk, and there's OBS. So you can do a lot more things with OBS as far as customization. We have teachers using in science using OBS to bring in their microscopes, so the kids at home can actually see the microscopes in action. Some really, really phenomenal stuff. I'm kind of going on a little bit too much here, so I want to kind of jump forward a little bit here. There's two things, you know, or just real quick to show some live shots of some things happening in our district before I move on. And I'm going to present this. And let's take my webcam off. So these are some live shots, some live from video that was done in some classrooms. I just want to show real quick here before we move into our teachers. You know, these are actual slides of the teachers themselves, you know, using OBS. On the board, you could see they have OBS up, so the kids in the classroom see, and you look over on her screen, there is OBS, you know, running, and the kids at home see it. And then in this scenario, our K-5, we have specialist help. The K-5 teachers, the hybrid students who are hybrid, they're included in the classroom, but they're at home. So, you know, the teachers jump in to teach specific, areas, ELA and math, and the hybrid teachers kind of control the classroom, and the other teachers jump in on those sessions during the day. In this scenario, you know, the actual hybrid teachers in the room with the teacher. In other scenarios, you know, in this scenario, you can see a teacher is teaching. You can see a webcam up on the left, and you can see, you know, all of, you know, her content, which she has that she's showing the kids. It looks like a math lesson for kindergarten students. And the hybrid teacher's in another room addressing questions and things. So, you know, we need that at the K-5 level, at the high school and middle school, the teachers pretty much control it all. This one here is, you know, shows a teacher actually, we had to go full virtual because of some COVID cases in our primary school. And this is a teacher quickly transitioned the next week to going from, you know, partially virtual, you know, jumping in on lessons with the hybrid teacher, to now becoming full hybrid or full virtual with all of her students. You can see the kindergarten kids at home connecting in, which is absolutely crazy that, you know, they can handle this, and they can. They've proved, they learned how to pin and unmute themselves. It's some pretty amazing stuff. And then this is one that shows the science teacher. Bottom left here, you can see her setup with her dot cam, her computer, her laptop, and then they have a spare monitor for her. She has a spare monitor. This is Mrs. Crane. And Mrs. Potter was in the previous video, and I guess I should mention everyone. And then we had Mrs. Rush and Mrs. Bossinger, and then in the second one, we had Mrs. Ferran and Miss Hawes. So this is their setup, and Mrs. Crane is one of the ones that uses, right now she's probably doing some kind of chemistry or something of that nature. And she's doing that in her classroom. And then this shows an EL, English teacher teaching. And it's actually the kids in the classroom. And you, to the left here, you can see of her, you could see of the kids at home. And in the high school, we are one day on, one day off. So half the kids are there one day and half the kids are at home. So they teach virtual all the time. So the last thing I want to do before I hand it over to our teachers to show some of this in action, I want to thank, you know, my immediate team, Rich Wilson and John Wengren, which is our analysts, and our my assistant director, and then Paul Brian, our integration specialist, Karen Ungst, who's an invaluable resource. She is our administrative assistant. And then Nick Truax, our data service specialist, who is our data guy, but has helped us tremendously through this. So that's all I have for my portion. I'm going to go ahead and hand it back to Mark.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Appreciate it. This has been really, really fascinating. And so at this point, I'm going to throw things open. I know we've had a bunch of questions come in. I'm going to go through the questions we've received so far, and we'll throw them open to Jeff and see exactly what kind of answers we get. One question we have here is that COVID forced a lot of schools into panic mode to get better at distance learning. Can you describe your distance learning capability pre-COVID? Did you have a long way to go to get to where you are today? And where did some of the funding for all of this come from?
I'll go ahead and answer that. The reality is, I think, you know, every district was in a bit of disarray in the spring, and there was no exception for our district to, you know, was the same way at that time. You know, it was difficult. You know, we had technology, we've been using it, and it was more along the lines of, you know, to supplement. It's always to supplement. And that's one thing that, you know, is a big theme in our district and always will be. Technology does not drive curriculum in our district. It's, you know, curriculum drives technology. So when the need is there, you know, we come in as a technology group and we're problem solvers, and we make sure things happen. So yes, there was problems. There wasn't, you know, we were using straight Google Meet and, you know, in the classrooms, and there was challenges. We weren't prepared for it. Teachers weren't prepared for it. I mean, I my hat goes off to all of them. I want to say thank you to Erin. You know, she did a great job, and Greg, they both did a great job. And you can show you, we have fantastic teachers, and they're both fantastic, and they both, you know, ran with this. They're just two examples of many that have run with this. But yeah, it was probably comparable to most districts at that point in the spring. And you know, we knew we had to adjust, and that's, you know, why we kind of got aggressive. You know, most people thought we were kind of nuts for going in the direction we went, but we definitely aren't disappointed at this point that we did, because it's the best thing that ever happened to us.
And also another kind of follow-up question on, do you have multiple schools in the district? And just again, curious about funding. How did this impact your budgets?
Yeah, so, you know, our teacher laptops are part of, you know, we have a yearly refresh on our, you know, I basically like the, I go building by building. So basically a teacher will have the same laptop for 4 years. So, you know, there's no extra cost for the teacher laptop. Same design as we always do. You know, we have the integrated webcam. You know, we're moving into solid state and maybe a little bit more RAM because, you know, some of the complexity of what OBS and some of the things when people are taking it to the next level, you know, we need a little bit more RAM, but that was built in. Chromebooks, our one-to-one Chromebook initiative across the district was already built in, and that's on a refresh cycle. And, you know, the doc cams, we've had doc cams in classrooms. We had to supplement some. I would say we only needed about 15 or 20 to complete out what we needed to. So, you know, this solution and, you know, the Google Suite is, you know, free. You know, we're actually, you know, getting into the enterprise version of it for some of the advanced functionality of Google Meet. But the only, and OBS software was free. So budget wise, you know, we really didn't have to do a lot.
And you already had WhatsUp Gold at this point?
Yes.
Got it. Excellent. And you do, and you are supporting multiple schools, multiple campuses with this as well?
Yes. Yes. We have four schools. You saw Erin with her primary school, then we have an intermediate, a middle, and a high, and they're all in different locations.
Interesting. Does that present any additional challenges?
No, we have, it goes back to infrastructure. We have leased fiber between our buildings. So, you know, we have a solid connection. It's almost like they're together, but they're not. You know, Greg's schools, I'm in the primary school with where Erin's at, and Greg's over at the high school. And he's just across the lot, but our two other schools are about 2 miles. And then our one school is probably 5 miles, maybe distance wise. So it hasn't presented a problem.
So just a follow-up question about that. What kind of, backup system are you using across these schools? What kind of bandwidth are you using to connect them? And are you taking advantage of any cloud resources, or is this all of physical infrastructure?
The actual district itself, or the connections between our, it's leased fiber. So we're actually 10 gig between our buildings, and that's done by our switches because it's dark fiber. It's not like community fiber. So we're able to, you know, have the high speed between those buildings. I think, you know, we measured out the company that does our fiber. I think the actual physical length of the fiber between here and our intermediate school is almost 20 miles. But, you know, with modern technology and the way switches work, it's like they're here. So that is that is not a problem. What was the other part of the question?
Sorry, I was asking, I'm putting too many here together. Are you using any cloud resources as part of your network?
Well, you know, of course, you know, Google is cloud-based. So yes, you know, that is our bread and butter. It's, you know, where the files are stored that the teachers use with the students. And we are transitioning to almost full cloud. Everything that we're doing is trying to move to the cloud just because, you know, in this virtual environment, we want everything to be accessible anytime, anywhere.
Does that include backups?
Yes, we do have a backup scenario with a backup with a company that is cloud-based. And we also have an appliance on premises that goes with that.
Nice. So did the PSBA provide any guidance or standards that they were looking for districts to follow, or were you guys just on your own?
There was no specific standards that were presented with us of how to do this. I think, you know, the state in general kind of let schools handle it in their own way because I really don't think they had the time to prepare anything, really. They were probably as much under the gun as we were. So there wasn't really anything provided. Everyone does it in their own way. And I'm sure everyone, you know, does it differently. and you know, there may be someone out there that does it better than us. You know, it's up to every district, at least in this state, that's how it is.
We have a question about Meraki. Someone was saying they're using Meraki for switches and wireless and firewall, and in the past they could not get much information on backbone uplinks or WAN connections. Do you have that functionality now?
Through WhatsUp Gold?
Yes, I think that's the question.
Truthfully, I haven't, the only thing that I'm using it for, because I don't have the switches. The only thing I use it at this point for is, you know, the access point, the API to get to the access points, and, you know, see the detail, the levels of detail that's available through the access point part of it. So, no, we currently don't.
Fair enough. What I can say is I know that WhatsUp Gold does have the capability to provide information and provide data based on everything we can get through the Meraki API. So WhatsUp Gold uses the Meraki API and should be able to feed through and alert on and report on any information that's accessible through that.
Mm-hmm.
Another question was, are there any additional security concerns with so many virtual students?
Well, in, you know, some of the things that we do, you know, with you know, microphones and the way the cameras are positioned. So, you know, that's always, a consideration, a part of this. And it's really something that is, you know, we're always looking at to improve upon. You know, we don't, we try not to record, you know, we record through OBS, which is another benefit, because when you record through Google Meet, it will record the students as well, you know, their pictures popping in, their you know, their voice. So, you know, recording through OBS is nice because you're just getting the teacher feed. So we try to do everything as possible as we can and as responsibly as we can. You know, realize that there's times where things happen, you know, discipline, you know, of course we have a new level of discipline now, you know, what the kids are doing home on their camera, you know. You know, we had some boys showing off their muscles and taking off their shirts. And so there's all kinds of different things that come into this scenario. So we're kind of, you know, developing those kind of policies and things, you know, and adding to it as we go. Again, the one thing we always talked about, and I know I talked to the progress people about this, but it is, you know, our theme was, you know, building an airplane, you know, in the sky, and I'm sure all districts feel that way, because this is so new, and, you know, it's, you know, usually you kind of work your way up. Education is a slow moving process, and before you jump into something like this, you go through all kinds of hoops to try to get it. Well, this was one that, you know, there was no way you could do that. It had to thrust into it so fast, you're just kind of building as you go, and that's the way. And by no means am I going to say, you know, that this process has been flawless, that there's, you know, hasn't been issues, and we work through them. And I think, you know, our group has done a fantastic job and overcome every issue. Like I said, administratively, the teachers themselves are astounding in the way they've worked with this solution.
Well, and that actually leads kind of into my next question, which is, you guys seem to be really advanced. The Danville Area School District was, and I know I'm sure it didn't seem this way to you on the inside, but from the outside, well-prepared, very responsive, very fast. You've gone over exactly how you had the equipment, put the solution together, trained your staff and your educators, and rolled this out, and you're being highly successful. I know for a fact we're going to have a lot of people coming, watching this webinar and going, okay, how did you get so advanced and how can we get there? What's your secret?
Well, I wish there was some magical secret, but, you know, I think it just, you know, as a group, and like I said, I continue, you know, it's something that has to be the buy-in from the top level all the way down, you know, through the whole system. And, you know, fortunately for us, you know, our school board, Our superintendent, Dr. Boyle, has been fantastic with moving forward. You know, she's definitely not afraid of trying new things. In retrospect, looking back, you know, right now we're like, oh, this, you know, I'm glad we did this. You know, we were scared, days even before. And Mr. Breon's there listening somewhere. We had discussions, we were leaping into the dark, but we had a lot of confidence in our people around us. We knew that it took a vast amount of preparation. We did a ton of testing on this solution to make sure that it was viable and we wouldn't have crashes on our laptops and things breaking down. So everything was reliable. So I think, the magic bullet of it all is just putting the work in and being prepared.
So we've been, from a business standpoint, watching everyone who can revert to remote work. And there's been a lot of questions of why haven't we been doing this all the time? And is anyone ever going to go back to the office full time? Are we looking at the future of education with what you've put together, Jeff?
Well, I think in some aspects we are. We talk about, how do we live without this before? Because, there's some problems with substitutes. We don't have enough substitutes. Now we can have one teacher teach two rooms at the same time, and it's something we utilize already. We definitely see a value in recording our classrooms and being able to, for kids that may have not caught everything, during the day, to be able to review it at night. That's another piece of this that we haven't talked a lot about. And, even hybrid kids that, maybe the parents don't show up until night with the smaller, students, because they do have to be involved in a cyber solution. So now, they can come back later at night and help those kids. So I think, it is something that's going to be part of what we do. By no means do we think it's better than in-person learning. There's nothing beats, the personal touch of being there with the students and being able to have that interaction. Even though we've come close to reproducing it, actually being in the same room is different. So I don't see it entirely going away. Who knows? It may, because it just, our society may demand it. But I do think that this is definitely something that's a game changer and will kind of change the way we think. I know it completely changes the way we think at the school district. We can say at any given moment, it could be, Thursday afternoon, we could say tomorrow we're going to give all our K-5, their Chromebooks, and, our 6-12 have them, take them home already, but we can have them go home Friday night, and then they could be virtual the following week if we want them to. And there's really not much transition wise from the teachers, because they do it every day. So it is changing it around here.
Well, honestly, that's a fantastic example you've shown us, and it's really fascinating. I think we've had a lot of people who are very interested. I know we've gone a bit over our planned time, but I'm going to try and wrap it up here at about 90 minutes. Jeff, Greg, Erin, thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much for all the work you put in on this. We really appreciate this, and we're so delighted to hear and to see what you guys have been doing. It's really, really impressive.
Well, thank you, Mark. It's a pleasure.
All right. Thanks, everyone. I think we're going to wrap at that. Thank you very much for your time, for attending, and we hope you have a fantastic day and a fantastic rest of your week. Stay healthy.